It's certainly difficult to stay ahead of the times right now because everything's happening so fast. It's a great challenge, actually, and it's very stressful. The times require an uber effort, and it's possible, and it's happening, but it's not easy, and we have to dig a little deeper, really, and get a little greater clarity, and at some point you wonder, wow. It's really quite something to have to do this, because the world is really, the dominoes are falling and the attitudes are crystallizing. Crystallization can happen very fast. As you know, when you cook, sometimes with high heat, you're cooking and things can happen fast. The egg can, you know, really, egg yolk can suddenly coagulate very fast. And so that's what's happening in the world. It's all crystallizing, wham, a chemical reaction, really. I mean, all of this really is a chemical reactions, actually. Even attitudes, thoughts, attitudes, all this stuff really is chemical reactions in dreaming, as it were. We've set up the system. So reactions can happen very quick. You throw in catalysts to, and it catalyzes the reaction. And so we have to get into the nitty-gritty more than ever, if that's possible. It is possible, but it's a challenge. I've spoken about bliss. Bliss is the key. And yet, even speaking about that, they're still like, yeah, but the pressure is on. What to talk about next? What to talk about next? Relocation. I've spoken of that. It may be that relocation is imminent, because it doesn't, it once crystallization of the mania of the world becomes manic, then it's a different ball game. It's a different ball game. People have experienced situations where people who are helping others, they come across people who are on drugs or are manic or somehow flipped out, and it takes a while to calm them down. Like, initially they're not receptive. If somebody's on terrible, you know, methamphetamine or something that's causing them to just act crazy, sometimes you have to use a stun gun on them. So sometimes you have to subdue them, and then later on the effect of the drug wears off, then you can talk. But they're not, it's not always possible to reach people through traditional means, and sometimes you just have to get out of the way. Like when nature goes on a rampage, when a tsunami comes in, you can't sit there on the shores and talk to the tsunami and say, "Hey, tsunami, slow down. We gotta talk things over here." No, it's not gonna do that. That's not how it works here. In dreams, in hypothetical land, it doesn't work that way, because the tsunami will say, "Well, I'm hypothetical and you're hypothetical, and so hypothetically, what if I don't stop?" And you say, "Well, I want you to hypothetically stop." Tsunami will say, "Well, what if I want to hypothetically not stop?" And won't listen. So we're not in a situation where we can tell everything to stop. Say, "Hey, wait a minute, slow down, take a time out here." Nah, it's not. It doesn't happen that way. It's not happening that way. The world is not taking a time out. Its events are cascading, snowballing, avalanching, tsunami-ing. That's hard to say. Tsunami-ing. And they're coming at us like that. And it's like, uh-oh. Doesn't look like the old approaches work anymore. So there's this shock of old approaches simply not working. And it's like, wow. We tend to go into shock, actually. The trick is to not go too deeply into shock and pull yourself out of the shock, which is what I'm trying to do. Right now, really, the only approach that works is refuge, retreat. Retreat is approach too. It is an approach too. It's a strategic approach to the situation. See, the assumption is that there's supposed to be some linear approach. It's not true. It's not true. It's only a retreat in linearness. It's not a real retreat at all. It's a remarshaling of focus a refocusing and a preparing for great efforts and helpful efforts. There's a time to sow the seeds and a time to harvest the crop, and there's also a time to wait and water. You know, you can't be harvesting the crop right after you sow the seeds, and there may be a period of time where you have to just wait, but it's not really a retreat. It's a tactical maneuver. Tactical maneuver. So we have to make tactical maneuvers right now. As the ego employs tactics, we have to employ tactics. And retreat is a tactic, as it were. Refuge. Sidestepping. I call it sidestepping. Sidestepping. You just step around the situation so that you meet up down the road and you're just fine. Fine and dandy. And it's like someone who's dying of thirst and insists that you're giving him water and that you're trying to poison him or something. They're paranoid. They get paranoid. So you have this beverage. And you say, here you go. Here you go. And they say, no, you're trying to poison me. And so they get more and more thirsty. They're so dehydrated. And you say, look. Water's fine, good, no problem. I say, no, it's a trick. There's a point where severe, in depression, where severe paranoia comes up. Severe mania, severe paranoia, all these very, very virulent symptoms of severe depression. And at that time, you have to just back off. And later on, it'll dissipate. And then you offer them the drink and say, here's bliss. Here's to your bliss. And they'll say, oh yeah, that looks good. I think I'll have some. So therapists have to realize that there's a time for them to shut up. It's not a reflection on their therapy. In fact, that just shows how artful the therapist is, actually. That they see the big picture. They don't lose sight of the goal and are not worried about, you know, one step backwards. We have to let them take one step back, so two steps forward can be taken. It's not really the therapists that are retreating. It's the patients that are retreating. And the therapist has to let them retreat. Retreat what? Into greater depression? Yes. But, again, greater depression bottoms out into a determination and a realization that this isn't it. You see, depression is a goal. It is not seen as a goal. It's like a shadow that accompanies a direction. And the attempt to go in that direction ends up ultimately even beyond depression, which is total mental chaos. And at that point, you realize, wow, this isn't it. This direction is wrong, fundamentally wrong. And you have an epiphany and say, wait a minute, I have to go in the other direction. And then you get determined, and then you start being willing to listen. People are not listening now in the world. It's amazing. They're not listening. They're in a mania. Then they're going to get in. And paranoia is another symptom of depression. So there's a mania, there's a paranoia, there's a scapegoating, there's a witch hunt, you know, it's a kind of a fervor that people don't quite realize. The world's in a very state of fervor right now. It's getting worse and worse and worse and worse, and the decisions become worse and worse and worse. And frivolity is getting worse and worse. All these attempts to solve the problem in ineffectual ways are getting more and more severe. And it's simply the patient is taking a step backwards, which is okay. It's okay. Because out of that will come further fruitfulness. It's kind of like you have fruit trees, and sometimes in the winter after you need to prune the trees. You need to prune the trees, and out of that comes a greater crop. So a little pruning work has to be done. And there's a fallow period. There's a fallow period. And right now you have to say the world's in a fallow period. Even though it seems to be frantically doing so much, it's actually frantically doing so little. Frantically doing so little. Almost nothing's being accomplished in the world right now. It's going into a lockdown state of non-accomplishment, of total irresponsibility. And again, that's temporary. That's temporary. The ego will celebrate it as permanent victory. It's mistaken, because there's something within us that will tell the ego, you're wrong, ego. Because I know that's what happens. The ego gloats and say, I won permanent victory over you. And then you say, wait a minute, I don't like this. I think I'm going to change it. And the ego, you're mistaken. I'm not what you say that I am. So it's the ego. Let the ego crow. Let the ego crow. That's okay. Because you will suddenly, at one point, you will say, hey, wait a minute, you're wrong, ego. So you won't be crowing for long. I'm going to divest idols of their presumed power over me. And then that starts. So let the ego crow. Let every dog has its day. Let the ego have its day. That's the attitude that we have to stay ahead of the game right now. We have to get into this attitude. Let the ego have its day. That's not a problem. At some time, the patient will turn on the therapist and say, therapist, you're terrible. You don't know anything. You're all wrong. I hate you. Get out of my life. And the therapist will say, okay, not a problem. And then later on, the patient says, hey, therapist, I really need help. Will you come back? And say, sure, not a problem. So the therapist is not leaving. It's just that the patient is requesting the therapist to back off. So the therapist says, sure, no problem. The world doesn't want us here. That's no problem. We'll go somewhere else for a while. Because the people are intimidated by the ego still, right now. But once you bottom out and realize that you can't handle the total chaos, it's not something the mind can handle, you realize the ego has led you down there and you're not happy about it. And you say, ego, your days are numbered. I mean, I'm going to break the spell that you have on me. And then the therapist says, welcome back into the picture. So what we need at this point is, again, continual reassurance, relocation, reassurance. As therapists, we have to be willing to let the patient go on their way and not be worried about it, because, again, all they face is severe depression and then total mental chaos, and the mind survives that. The mind can't be destroyed, but the mind doesn't like total chaos. It rejects it. It says, no, this is not it. This isn't it. And then it gets on the path to what is it. So there's no danger of anyone being lost or anything like that. No, not at all. So to stay ahead of the mania, you need to become flexible at sidestepping. And flexibility means humility. The humility of a therapist to let the patient gloat for a while. See, the patient's trying to prove that they know more than you do. The ego's trying to say, what the patient is saying is that idols know more than God. Or that idols know, what idols know is just as relevant as what God knows. It's different, but it's just as relevant. That's like saying hypotheticals are just as relevant as reality. To what? Relevant to what? To other hypotheticals? But well, hypotheticals are nothing. That's like saying nothing is equally relevant to nothing, as is reality to reality, which is a meaningless statement. So hypotheticals aren't relevant to reality, not relevant to anything. So the patient wants to elevate idols into, you know, total relevance, more relevant than reality, or equally relevant or more relevant. And temporarily then they will you want to use the therapist to showcase the power of idols, whereas the therapist's not interested in that, knowing that that's not helpful for the patient. It's not helpful. So the therapist realizes it's really a request for the therapist to get out of the picture. So the therapist will say, okay, not a problem. They may have to say, well, I'm not able to see you for a little while. But they know that the patient is insisting that they get out of the way so that idols can have their day. And the therapist says, okay, you'll see where idols lead you, and they'll lead you down into the pit. And down there you will discover that you don't like where idols lead you, and then you'll say, hey therapist, where are you? Are you anywhere? Is there any therapist in the house? And then therapist will say, sure. Absolutely. Why don't we go back into therapy? And then they'll say, yeah, that's a good idea. That's a very good idea. And then they'll start talking about the experience. They said, hey, I had these experiences, you know, I went down the depression and all that, went through all this stuff, is terrible. And the therapist will say, yeah, absolutely. And they'll say, why didn't you stop me? He said, well, you didn't want to be stopped. You thought you were going to prove something. And it'll be worked out. It'll be worked out long term. Therapy is a long term thing. And it gets worked out along the way eventually. It's ragged, it's rough, it's not all smooth, but in the final analysis, end of the day, it does get worked out, and you say, ah, okay, you did the right thing, no worries. So how to stay ahead of the curve, how to stay ahead of the tsunami, how to stay ahead of the mania, how to stay ahead of the scapegoating, how to stay ahead of all of this stuff, the crystallization of the world, how to stay ahead of that. That's what we're trying to do. And boy, it's really a challenge. I feel like I'm getting a little bit, you know, behind the game. Behind times, behind the situation. The problem is it requires more of a vertical type of consideration than a horizontal one. So you really have to be willing to accept big vertical ideas, as it were, like relocation, as a remedy, instead of a horizontal one, let's outrun the tsunami, that kind of thing. Imagine if a tsunami was coming at you and you only thought horizontally. So you said, well, I gotta get on a motorcycle, I gotta run, get a motorcycle, horse, car, whatever I can do, I gotta outrun this tsunami, I gotta go faster, horizontally. But what if you said, here comes a tsunami, it's like 10 feet high, why don't you just elevate 15 feet high? You elevate 15 feet high, and the tsunami goes right underneath you, doesn't even touch you. You don't have to worry about horizontal movement at all. See, it's thinking vertically instead of horizontally. So what we really need to do is switch over to this vertical type of thinking. Relocation is like a vertical solution, not a horizontal. What I see in the world is everybody's thinking horizontally. I see all, you know, I've been recently doing a evaluation of what's going on in the world, which has really been difficult on me, because it's the same old, only worse. And I see that people are pointing out all this terrible stuff that's happening, which is true, but they're only thinking horizontally. Only thinking horizontally. How much gun and ammo can they get? That's horizontally. That's thinking horizontally. Thinking, where are the safe places in the world? That's horizontally. Looking horizontally. In other words, let's outrun it. There's no vertical thinking going on. It's lost to them. So I've been trying. What I've tried to do in the world is to get people to think vertically. And it's not easy. So, Jesus tried to help people see, think vertically. When he got on the mountain of about to leave, they said, "Where are you going? You can't leave us. How can you leave us?" They were thinking horizontally. In other words, wherever you go, we're going to go. You're going to, you know, go through the Galilee, Dead Sea, wherever you travel in this world horizontally. He said, "We're going to follow you. We're going to be there." And Jesus says, "Ah, where I'm going right now, you can't follow me right now, but later you'll be able to." And then he, up into the clouds, left vertically. They couldn't follow, you see? And they were like, wow, dumbfounded. Hadn't thought of that one. But he said, you can't, where I'm going now, you can't follow me at this point. But later on, you will be able to follow me. So that means at this time, which is a tribulation time, we'll be able to go vertically. We'll be able to go vertically. Won't have to worry about the horizontal problems. Let a 1,000-foot tsunami sweep across the world horizontally. We're above it. We're above it. Vertically. So relocation is a vertical situation. We're not trying to dodge the long arm of the New World Order. We're not trying to dodge it horizontally. Stay one step ahead horizontally. No, just relocate, sidestep vertically. The solution is vertical. Now in dreams, darkness can signify lack of power, disempowerment. Because what happens when our houses go all dark? There's no power. When the power goes out, what happens? Darkness. Things don't work. They've gone dark. We call it going dark. There's no power. No power. So when you see a dream where everything goes black and dark, it means disempowerment, severe disempowerment. I had a dream like that just recently. And the only ones that had power were the banks. Financial system, banking system, had accumulated all power in their hands and nobody else had any power. So everything was pitch black, dark, except for the banks. They had light, that means they had power. I also saw a dream back in 1997 that showed the future, and that showed what's happened. It's been very accurate, and I saw ahead on the road, I saw this big, looked like a big black mountain, just right in the way of the road. The road's ended there. It was a completely black mountain, pitch black. What it really meant was complete disempowerment. Complete disempowerment. People stay in this world will be disempowered. Disempowered. And what people are reacting to right now in the world is this disempowerment that's happening. There's been an incredible disempowerment already happened in this world. Incredible. And that's just the tip of the iceberg. There's really going to be a drastic disempowerment soon. And so that the road ending in this dark mountainside, like a cliff, black cliff, means severe disempowerment, total disempowerment. You can't function anymore. You feel you have no more power. And at that point, then you're willing to settle for crumbs. Right, when you feel so disempowered, you'll be grateful for a little crumb that will be given to you. Here's a little crumb. That's your empowerment. That's what you got to live off of. And people will then be, you know, cult-like followers of these crumbs. Certainly not something that we want. We don't want to be disempowered. We want to be truly empowered. Which is what spiritual therapy really does. But truth leads us to back to realization. We never left reality, which is all power, true empowerment. So we are reacting right now to the disempowerment that's happening. It's happening every day. It's happening more and more and more and more and more. And the banks will inform us more and more and more that we our money d isn't really our money. It's not really money. It's a partnership with the banks. It's ownership in the banks. It's it that there's you know it's not actual money. So they'll say, you know, you don't really have any power except in relationship with the banks. That's the only power you really have. That's the and the banks will say, now here's how we're going to share this power, you see, through digital stuff and marks and chips and all these kinds of things. So we're getting there very, very quickly, very, very fast, and people are alarmed, of course. They recognize the jig is up. And if they haven't been thinking vertically, they're going to be getting very restive. Those who are stuck in horizontal thinking are, of course, going to be reacting in all sorts of ways, which is why the powers that be are preparing to contain the restiveness. But if you're thinking vertically, you're not getting restive. You're not getting all restless and agitated. No, you're saying, okay, it's no problem, no worry, no disempowerment here. So it's very important to stay calm and to keep thinking vertically, to keep listening to those who are helping you think vertically, not horizontally. Horizontally is a big trouble. All right, whoever has the most ammo wins. Think about that. Everybody's talking about getting ammo, but they don't realize that the ammo suppliers, if they're supplying the opposition and you're not, they're not supplying you, you're gonna run out of ammo, right? And the other side won't run out of ammo. Firepower wins wars. And yeah, when the other side runs out of ammo, game's over. I mean, there's plenty of people. It's the ammo that's the question, right? So it's horizontal thinking to think that way. You're up against power structure, and this isn't the Alamo or something. No, this is hardball. This is hardball that's taking place in the world. So think vertically. Think vertically, and you say, we'll just take a spring break. Just take a spring break time. What I was jubilee time. Take a jubilee from the world. We're taking a break from the world. Get the dust off. Get the dust off and refresh, refresh. Take a little break, a little recess period, which is fine. It's like you're having a seminar. You have a long seminar in the morning. You take a little break, then you have one in the afternoon. So it's basically break time in the world. It's time to take a break from the world. So everybody can kind of catch their breath. So this period of acting out can happen. And then we'll get back to serious business of salvation. And people will get it. You know, they'll gradually get it. So this attitude that's important right now, it's vertical attitude. It's attitude. It's attitude. Don't get pulled into the panic. Which looking at all these websites and stuff was really affected me very badly. I'm still trying to get free of it. It's a problem. It's best not to look at the news. Best not to look at the websites. Best just to forget all that. But I still want to make one last effort to see, is anybody reachable here? I said, no. Okay. Is this reachable? What's the attitude? I said, ah, no, it's not possible. Not possible. I mean, I just want to take one last look and just to be sure. And I saw what just, whew, forget it. Loss, at this point, lost cause. Lost cause. The people are definitely not thinking vertically at all. Even the ones that have the vertical rhetoric are not thinking vertically. They're still talking about making this world their home. That's not vertical thinking. It's not vertical at all. They're trying to combine the two. vertical with the horizontal. Let's make them one, and let's use the vertical to make the horizontal what we really want, develop its potential, as it were. So that's not it either. So it's not happening in the world now. It's not happening. Yeah, I took one last look around, but that's enough. That's enough for me. No more. No mas. Got to make some decisions, you know. You have to make decisions. You have to say, okay, enough is enough. That's it. No mas. It's like Roberto Duran. He says, hey, does this guy want to fight, or does he want to clown around? And he said, he says he wants to clown around, forget it. I came here to fight, and that's where the no mas came from. The famous no mas fight, Roberto Duran against Sugar Ray Leonard. And Duran said, hey, this guy wants to clown around, forget it. It's not worth it. I don't want to do that. No mas. And he just stopped it and said, it's not worth it to me. He says, I got my dignity. I don't need this championship. Dignity is more important than a championship belt. It's important to be able to say no mas. That's enough. We've taken the temperature. We know the temperature. We don't have to keep taking the temperature. We know what's going on, and we know what's the whole situation is what it is. There's no reason to keep on dragging yourself through the mud. It's like you go in an outhouse and you smell it, and it smells terrible, and you say, it smells terrible. You go back again. Years later, you smell it, it's even worse. And you say, okay, I don't have to keep going in there all the time. I know this is an outhouse. This is terrible, so it smells terrible. Don't have to keep on doing that. So horizontal thinking is horizontal thinking. It's not vertical. No matter how you parse it, it's not vertical. No matter how you slice a pizza, it's still a pizza. Doesn't matter where you cut it in half, quarters, 16ths, eighths, whatever. Big pieces, little pieces, however you slice it, it's still the same pizza. And so everybody's just slicing and dicing their pizza and saying, hey, what about this? I say, well, what is it? What is a pepperoni and pineapple pizza? It's the same pizza. Why are you offering me another piece? Hey, how about this piece? I say, what's different? They say, well, it's cut. It's a thin piece. I cut you a thin piece. I said, well, it's still pepperoni and pineapple pizza. I don't want any. And they say, well, let me cut you a different piece. How about this piece? It's a big piece. No, I don't want the same pizza. Then they're just perplexed, like, huh? How come I don't want this pizza? How come I keep changing it for them? And they say, no, you're not changing the pizza. You're just changing the proportion that you're serving. It's still the same stuff. And so at some point, the mind can just flip out and just decide to just go crazy and just go berserk, basically. And really, berserkness can happen in this world. There's a time when one is going deeper into depression, which the world is right now, where you don't see any way out, and you recognize you're in a terrible free fall, and you're scared, very scared, and nothing seems to work, and you're totally confused. You're lost. Your mind goes whimsical. And it goes berserk. It can go berserk. It doesn't realize it's berserk. It goes manic. It goes manic and berserk. And at that point, it's not rational anymore. It goes manic and says, "We just got to do all this stuff. I just did that. I just put in a big garden. Oh, just about killed myself. I knew it was my last chance, so I said, I got to get it done now. So I did it real fast, but it was too much. But the world, when it goes down in a depression, realizes this is the last chance to halt this free fall. doesn't know how to halt it. It just says, let's just throw everything against the wall and see what sticks. So the world seems to go crazy. It goes into a world war. It goes into panic, depression, bank runs, everything. People just say, we got to do something. So let's just do as much as possible, but without really thinking it through too much. They cannot. They lose the ability to sit quietly, reflectively, and observantly, and to focus on bliss. They lose. They temporarily cast that aside, and say, "We're just going to throw everything in the air. Just throw it all in the air. See what happens. Just blow it all up. But let's just completely kaboom and see what happens." That's what war does, doesn't it? I mean, it just devastates cities, everything, infrastructure, everything just gets torn to pieces. And then people say, okay, maybe this works. Maybe this works. Maybe this will pull me out of my depression. And when that doesn't work, then they get serious. They say, wow, that didn't work. And then they start praying for help, and then they listen. So we're not at a point in the world where people are listening. So we're at the point where they're ready to go berserk. And everybody, wise people know, and just we all have wisdom. The wisdom within us knows when like some crowd in Malaysia, someone's going berserk with a machete or somewhere, you know. People just get out of the way. They don't go up try to reason with the person because they recognize that this person is temporarily gone berserk because they're like super depressed and hopeless and they're trying to make something happen and eventually they'll get tired and exhaust themselves. Let them go hack some palm trees or something. Just get out of their way. And when they're tired, they'll drop the machete and then they'll be willing to talk and they'll say, what's the problem? They say, oh, everything's gone wrong with my life. I got no hope. Everything's terrible. I can't take it anymore. And then I just need help. And then they'll say, okay, we'll help you. We'll help you out. Not a problem. So it's like that. Is we see more and more people going berserk actually now, which is something I basically foretold some time ago. I'm saying you're going to see almost every day now you're going to see someone going berserk. Almost every day. And it'll get worse and worse and worse. And this is before the bad stuff happened. But I knew it was going to happen. And it's, you know, it's going to escalate. And there's no rhyme or reason. And people scratch their heads and how come we didn't see this coming? I said, well, because it's a collective thing. Because you yourself are depressed. The whole world is depressed. Very few people in the world are not severely depressed, actually, right now. And I'm not even talking about the ones who are on antidepressants and therapy and stuff. The whole world is extremely depressed. And at that point, they don't even recognize that they're going to go berserk. So there's really no safeguards. There's two, you know, when the world collectively goes this way, that is a big problem. Whereas in the past, people were not quite this depressed, and they're able to notice someone else who was, and help them out. But the world is so engrossed in its own depression that it doesn't even notice this. Like when I got severely depressed, nobody noticed. Nobody noticed. It's amazing, incredible, astonishing thing. I went for my whole life almost severely depressed. Nobody said a thing. Nobody noticed. Nobody really said, "Hey, you seem really depressed, or you know, something isn't right. I mean, things aren't going well for you, huh?" Nobody said anything. It's unbelievable, unbelievable. That just shows that we're so intimidated at this point. We're not even willing to speak up. I see people all the time. I say, "Hey, I can tell you're really, really depressed," but there's this taboo against saying anything. Because everybody else is depressed too, and they think, well, if we just don't recognize it, it should be okay. Let's just deny it. Deny. And you should be able to get well, you know, just doesn't happen that way. You get severely depressed. There's a reason, because you're trying to make both truth and lies true. Entertain them both at the same time, and that leads to incredible depression. You become a spiritual dilettante instead of truly sober pilgrim on the path. Leads to depression, severe depression. The world doesn't want to admit that it's become dilettante, and it doesn't want to admit it's dropped its efforts, and it doesn't want to admit any of that stuff. It's bluffing, and that leads to severe depression. Nobody wants to recognize it, so of course people are going to go berserk. And it's been happening more and more. And you'll see it collectively happen, and ultimately leads to world war. Financial panics, collapses, bank runs, world war, all this stuff is because of dropping right spiritual effort, right use of time, right use of mind. It's because of that. But of course, the idols have told us that that's the way to success, so people are not willing to give up on idols yet. Because they made the idols. It's like a mirror. They're not willing to give up on the mirror yet, because they made what's in the mirror. They think the mirror reflection of this somehow makes it different than what it is. It's like a magic trick. But it's just us in the mirror. That's all. It's not someone else in the mirror. Idols are just our attempts to accomplish the impossible. But we think it's coming from somewhere else. So it's endowed with some... It can't... We know what we're trying to do is impossible. But when we see it coming from an idol, we feel it's possible. Because it's not our futility. See, we know what we're doing, we're trying to do is futile. But they say, it's not us. It's the idol that's doing it. Hey, maybe it can succeed. See, it's not, idols are not under the strictures of reality of God, that they're somehow separate from God, so they may have some separate power, some capability to accomplish the impossible. So we don't see it as, we don't realize it's us in the mirror. We think it's somebody else. Someone similar, but with some kind of magical power. So we're not ready to give up on idols. The world's not ready to give up on idols yet. They want to give one last big push for idols. And so the idols are telling, they're following the advice of the idols, which is really their own advice of how to try and accomplish the impossible. And then that leads down into severe depression, which isn't recognized as such. It's not understood, in the confusion, mental confusion. Then they have to get out of that and gradually recognize how they got there. They're confused. They don't understand how they got there. Because what they thought was they're going towards success. And the success they thought didn't turn into success. The idols told them, no, if you just push it all the way to the end, you'll get success there. And what you get is total chaos. And then that's not success. They say, wait a minute, this isn't success. And they realize, hey, wait a minute, the idol didn't give me the right information. They lied to me. But how do they lie? And then you have to therapy gradually helps you clarify of trying to make lies and truth and lies equally true, and all this stuff that leads us down into that pit. So the world doesn't recognize that it's depressed right now. Doesn't. I mean, I'm here, I could tell people, I've been here my whole life, say, hey, people, if you want me to say something, I'll say something. Nobody wants me to say anything. Nobody's ever asked me to say anything in this world, believe it or not. See, I'm just doing this on my own initiative. There's been some here once I did the initiative that have asked for some more videos, which is good. But as far as just in the world, going around my life, nobody's ever asked me for any advice whatsoever in my entire life. Nobody. Nobody's interested in what I have to say. So they say, there's nothing there. He can't give me any advice. He doesn't know anything. So never ask for advice. Crazy, isn't it? But I could have given them advice. And still, nobody asks for advice. I just sit back and tell, hey, the situation's coming a cropper, and nobody wants any advice. That's right. They want to listen to idols. They don't want... to listen to the Holy Spirit informed advice at all. They want to figure out how to succeed on this path. They don't want to hear you can't succeed. They believe the idols will find a way because idols aren't them. They think the idols have some special power. Idols are nothing. Idols are nothing. Like a mirror. They just reflect what's in front of the mirror. They don't have any special power. That people don't know that. So the world doesn't realize it's depressed. The global depression. Psychological depression. It thinks it's progressive. It's progressing. It thinks it's making all this progress. It thinks like, wow, things are great. That's how depression sneaks up on you. But just look at the medication everybody's taking in the world. Just look at the way they're acting. They have to try and reinforce their notion of success desperately, more and more desperate, which has led to, of course, the banking crises in the world. As you get more and more depressed, you become more and more desperate, and you take more and more chances and gamble more and more with money to get things, to get more stuff to medicate your depression, really. And so you get the financial system of the structure of the world. And for a while, they can hide it by just printing money. Print. It's like medication for depression, but it doesn't cure it. Doesn't cure it, and often makes it worse. When you take medication for depression, it can make it worse. It can temporarily, in some cases, help out. Other cases, it doesn't do anything. In some cases, it makes it worse. But it's not a cure. It's not a cure by any stretch of the imagination. The hope is that it will cure. So that what's going on in the world is there's a hope that this cure will work. But that's unlikely. It's unlikely. Ultimately, there's a desperate effort to make sure there's no bank runs. But the inner psychology of the people in the world is leaning so much towards depression that I'm not at all convinced that people are going to chill out. Some places will more than others, but there is a strong possibility. I see it as an inevitability from viewing the future, is that that people will run on banks, take their money out of banks. And everybody's thinking about it right now, as a matter of fact. Let's not kid ourselves. Everybody is thinking, hey, maybe I should take my money out of banks. You know. And for a while, just for a while, just until things cool down, right? Now, I'm certainly not advising that what people should do. I'm talking about the depressive cycle, how it works, and how it leads one down the rabbit hole very badly. And the world is based on trying to avoid the bad part of going in the wrong direction. The symptoms of going in the wrong direction throw up these symptoms of depression. And you keep wanting to believe your idols, so you keep following that direction, but you're just desperate, but it's causing more and more symptoms, so you want to get rid of the symptoms. You're suffering so bad, but you won't give up on the idols, your idols that you've made. So you're just desperate to get rid of the symptoms. And so the world is following idols now. It's not following truth at all. So that means the symptoms will get worse and worse, which means the efforts to get rid of the symptoms will become more and more severe, more and more desperate efforts. Eventually, people go berserk trying to shake off. You know, it's like somebody's on fire. When someone's on fire, they're going to be like dancing around, whirling, screaming, you know, acting berserk, right? Because they're trying to get rid of that fire. It's a sensible response if you're on fire, but it's not very effective. So, it's fairly predictive what's going on in the world if you understand depression and the lack of dedicated efforts towards clarity and acceptance of bliss. That inevitably leads to depression, inevitably. And you just look at the world and say, how much true dedication is going on? Oh man, it's hard to find. And collectively, you might say it's almost virtually nil, which means depression is going to be just rampant, absolutely rampant, which means efforts to get rid of those symptoms are going to be rampant. People are now following idols to an extraordinary extent. And again, that brings up these problems which require drastic steps to get rid of the symptoms so we can keep following the idols. Because what the problem is, we're more afraid of losing the idol than we are losing symptoms, the suffering. So we're willing to put up with enormous suffering instead of dumping the idols. And for most people, I would say that they will follow idols to the bitter end of total mental chaos. And at that point, they have no choice but to dump the idol. No choice. But up till then, they won't dump the idol. Because idol is their secret power. They believe it's a power over God that can accomplish the impossible, which they believe is their salvation. So they don't want to dump what they believe to be their salvation, the idol, until they reach mental chaos. And then once they reach that point, they say, hey, forget it. I got no choice but to dump this, dump the idol. And then how does one live without idols? Well, you turn to the Holy Spirit, which then leads you to bliss, ultimately. So people are not going to dump their idols here in the world. They won't do it. Won't do it. They see it as their salvation. So idols give the wrong advice, the wrong direction, which leads to severe depression, severe symptoms, which leads to people taking drastic steps to deal with those symptoms. And it gets worse and worse and worse and worse. It's a downward spiral. And that's what the world is in right now. Downward spiral. Free fall. Virtual free fall. It's still spiraling, but the spirals are getting tighter. It's like, let's say, a bathtub full of water. And you pull the plug, and gradually the water drains out. But all you see is the tub getting lower and lower and lower and lower and lower. You don't see the centripetal. Centrifugal force or centripetal that's pulling inward. And I guess you call it centripetal force. The whirlpool effect. And as the level gets lower and real low, then you start to see, that by the drain there's like a hole kind of in it, and you see it, the water swirling, going in a direction like this, clockwise and one hemisphere counterclockwise in the other. And then you see it, and then you see, but you see the water at the far end of the tub. It's still just sitting there. It's not swirling. It's only the water that's close to the drain that is going around and around and around. But as the water from the foot of the tub gets closer and closer and closer to the drain, you say, "Oh my gosh, that's going to be swirling around, around, and around, around too." So and once it goes down drain, there's no more swirling. It's a free fall at that point, right? No more swirling around. No more circling around. It's straight down. So the spiral, as you get closer to the drain, the spirals get tighter, right? Far away, it's just a real slow spiral. Closer, it's a tighter spiral. Get real close, it's going around and around real fast. So the world is like getting closer and closer to the drain. And therefore, the spiraling is tighter and tighter and faster and faster. And soon, whoosh, through the drain, free fall. And as some people say, uh-oh, uh-oh, uh-oh. But again, there's a bottom. You bottom out. The biggest fear is that there's no bottom, that you don't bottom out. So the reason why I can talk the way that I can, because I know there's a bottom. I bottomed out. I know there's a bottom. Absolutely. You hit rock bottom, you experience mental chaos, and you say, that's it. Can't go any deeper than that. That's the end. That's the bottom. And then nowhere else to go, but say, I don't want that. So you say, okay. It's like you're diving down in the ocean. You hit the bottom, and you've got nowhere else to go but back up to the surface. That's what happens. So I'm not worried about the world. The people pray that they'll never hit the bottom, but they will. But it's the self-medication. It's taking place. So the world's medicating itself. You know, it's not turning towards sanity at all. It's not. Theoretically, there are those who could turn the world towards sanity. Absolutely. But the world's not listening. They again want to prove that their idols have a special power and can save them. They don't want God to save them. They want their idols to save them, which is just themselves, really. But themselves not realizing that it's themselves. See, no, that's not me. That's the idol that's helping me. Call it the idol whatever you want to. Call it God if you want to. I mean, people call idols whatever they want to. There's been a lot of names, right, given to idols. It doesn't matter if you have many idols or one idol. It's still an idol. This whole idea of monotheism is a scam. Because it's like saying, one person saying, hey, you've got lots of different idols here, and that's why you got a problem. And they say, what's the solution? Well, let's just take all those idols and turn them into just one idol, and then you're saved. See, no, you're still listening to idol. Why does it matter if you listen to one idol or 10? Same thing. The vice is the same. Vice is the same. So the idea that monotheism was some great leap forward is ridiculous. They're basically saying there's only one idol and he belongs to us and you have to pay tribute to us so that the idol will be our idol, the one idol will be good to you because we're the special chosen ones of that one idol. It's just a business thing. It's just a scam, a business scam to make money, to get power. So again, you can call the one idol, you can call it God, it's still an idol. It's still just you in the mirror, giving yourself advice but refusing to recognize because you realize that you can't advise yourself to do the impossible. But an idol, you see, they're special, you see, they're special. Something different, they're special, they're magical, they can do it. and so whether you've got a million idols or one is the same. Of course, it is easier to lay one idol aside, theoretically. Maybe. I would, you know, instead of trying to deal with 100 different idols, to say, well, I got rid of one, but 99 over here, say, I have just one idol, and then drop that one. Instead of looking in all of mirrors, you look into one mirror, and eventually you can say, ah, that too is an idol. So you could say, in the big picture, it is an advance to see one idol, but that one too has to be seen through. You can't stop there. I don't know if that's the intention of it. The intention of it was probably simply as a corporate takeover type of thing. Saying, here's all these little stores. Let's have one big Walmart take it over and put all those other stores out of business and we'll get all the business. If we say only one idol and this idol dwells in our temples, then you can get all the tribute to coming into your temple. You see? Is a business thing. It's a money maker. And that's the you know, blunt truth of, you know, the obvious truth of the situation. We can name idols whatever you want to name them. We can name the mirror, we call this mirror God, call it Jesus, call it whatever you want to call it. It's still just a mirror. And it doesn't endow the mirror with any special powers at all over reality. There are no powers over reality. Belief that there's powers over reality is idolatry. And saying, well, this mirror, this just one mirror is all powerful, the other ones have no power, that's still idolatry entirely. You haven't seen through the situation at all. So these things could be easily taught in the world, but the world doesn't want to listen. They say, no, our idols are going to succeed this time. We know it. Because they're now souped up. Hot rodded. We've hot rodded the idols. They're all souped up. They're all supercharged. They're all ready to go. And they're going to lead us to success. And eventually in the, among the ruins, the chaos, people will say, wow, our idols didn't lead us to success. This is terrible. What do we do now? And then the teachers are available, therapists saying, okay, let's take a look at what happened, and it's, you'll be able to do it. No problem. No problem. Maybe that's why I spend so much time in garbage dumps, is to just simply, I'm not affected by them at all, anymore at all. What you have there is like total chaos. It's like a world that's been completely destroyed. You go to a garbage dump, and a landfill, I mean, it's just chaos there, right? Everything shredded to pieces. And me, I go there and I just tune it out like it's nothing. And I can talk to the people that work there and say, hey, you know, how you doing? Just relate to them like, without getting all freaked out about where they're at. You know, they're like surrounded by total chaos. I said to the guy, you don't want to stay here forever, do you? You know, and he said, no. He said, you working on your resume? He says, yeah. I've got a possibility for another job. I said, good. Yeah, you don't want to stay here. But chaos doesn't freak me out. The garbage dumps don't freak me out. All that stuff is just, I don't let it, you know, get into me. So maybe that's like training, some kind of super training, probably. For me, you know, whether I'm in like a mansion, I find myself either in like these super mansions or at the garbage dump. That's true. And super mansions don't affect me any different than the garbage dump, really. My truth is true. Still true, it's exact same truth. So I'm sort of like indifferent to surroundings, pretty much. So as far as wherever situation, it doesn't really matter. The situation, the inner situation, is still the same. So it may be that, you know, the world is going to be plunged into chaos, very likely. And if we could see the future, we might say it's a certainty. And then the people, you know, survivors of all that are going to, like, be saying, my God, look at this, terrible. And you can't be squeamish about going into that situation and helping people out. You can't be freaked out about it. You can't be all precious about it and say, oh, I don't want to scratch my nails, you know, my toenails. I can't go in there. I got a real nice... pretty toenails and painting, where, and I can't scratch that up. I can't get any scratches on me. The smell, I don't like the smell. You know, you can't be that way. I get all the worst smells, the outhouse, the garbage dump, methane gas, you name it. Have to deal with all the dead stuff, the dead rats, the dead moles and gophers, and I mean, it's just like a sudra, you know, that kind of thing, untouchable. But in doing that, it's like, man, doesn't really freak me out at all. And therefore, the clarity is still there. Clarity is still there. If you get freaked out by it, and you're all worried, oh, you can't relate to people, and you can't just talk to them and calm them down and say, hey, no worries, no problem. And just be a calming, reassurance presence. And then let them know, hey, there's someone normal there, not bothered by anything, and they can... then relate to someone that way, and they find out they can relate to them, start saying, hey, you know, I wasn't destroyed, I can still relate, I can still communicate. And then they start realizing, hey, maybe I need to reevaluate, you know, let's figure out what happened. And I'm not desperately trying to clean up the garbage dump, which is all important, right? Because those are in chaos, they want to get out of it. they don't want to. At that point, they just want therapy. They don't want to clean up the dump. They don't want to say, oh, let's work on sanitizing the dump. They say, hey, I just want to get out of this, man. What happened? Just I want something more powerful than that. I want to find out. I want to know what happened. So I can't be someone who's like saying, oh, the dump is so terrible. Oh, it's, you know, I can't. Hey, you need to help me clean this up because I don't like being here. You know, if you want me to help you, you got to help me clean this up. You know, in other words, cop this attitude. Forget it. You know, no. Just let it be. Just let it be. Let it be what it is. Don't worry about it. And they'll say, where'd you come from? I mean, you don't seem like you're from here. I said, no, I came from a beautiful mansion, beautiful place. They say, why are you here? I said, well, I'm just here to help you, you know, relate to somebody and realize you can relate to that, still relate to that. Because in this situation, in a dump, you don't think you can relate to, you know, when we're in dreams, we don't think we can relate to reality. We think we've lost the ability. We can't relate to bliss. And so in chaos, doesn't think it can relate. So what therapy really is just somebody there that you can relate to, and you realize, hey, I can relate to this person here. I'm able to relate to them, and they come from this incredibly beautiful mansion, this beautiful place, and that means I can relate to them. I can probably relate to that beautiful place too. And then they gradually decide, hey, I'm gonna leave this dump. I'm gonna go to that beautiful mansion and hang out there instead. So it's like that. It's like that. So basically, again, my work takes me from beautiful, beautiful mansions and estates and stuff to the garbage dump. Go back and forth, back and forth, back and forth, that kind of thing. And I've just gotten, like, used to it. I don't even give it a second thought. So it's like on a battlefield. You know, everything's blown up. Dead bodies everywhere. It's just chaos and death and reeking and stench. And then there's some survivors there, and they're just like, oh my God, what happened? This is horrible. I can never relate to beauty and truth and life ever again. This is just, and then somebody walks onto the battlefield there and just say, hey, how you doing? Hi. You know, not bothered by it at all. It's just not even touched by it. And just say, hi, how you doing? What's your name? Yeah. Huh. Nice day, huh? Well, it's not such a great day. It's kind of a little cold today. And just make small talk and just communicate and let them know they can relate. And they start relating. And then they start noticing, well, where are you from? Yeah. You don't seem to be touched by any of this stuff. You say, no. I come from a place that's not a battlefield, but that's okay. No worries. You don't say, hey, bury all those corpses. You know, clean all this mess up. No. Let it be. It doesn't bother me at all. Let it be. And so then they realize, okay, I can relate to this someone here. I can relate to. I can communicate. And they're from a place that's not a battlefield. So maybe I can go there too. That's basically how it works. What I found is people that, like, at the dump, they're good people. They're not, like, the Sudras are not terrible people at all. They're not stupid. I relate to all of them very well. And just let them know, hey, you know, I may seem like some real patrician kind of, they kind of comment, like, what are you doing here? What are you doing at the dump? And I said, I don't know. I'm not really sure, but there must be some reason for it. And then I just relate to them at the level, you know, small talk, relate to them. And they're not stupid. They're not dumb. They can relate. They can relate. They can communicate. I treat them just like the same way I would treat the, you know, the king of the world. Same thing. Just relate to them. Well, what do you want to talk about? Whatever. Just letting them know that, you know, I don't see him as some kind of permanent, you know, part of the dump. I see this, look, your circumstances led you into this place, you know, right now, but, you know, we won't stay there forever, no way. So, you know, you might as well get used to something that's not part of the dump. And that's therapy, it's therapy. So when this world is in smoldering ruins, you know, there needs to be people come here and just say, okay, folks, here, let's come on over here and let's sit down and let's have a chat. I said, okay, sit down. Maybe all the trees are dead. You sit down beneath a dead tree. That's okay. No worries. And then in that relating, they begin to forget about their surroundings and say, hey, no, maybe it's not such a big deal. Maybe I don't need to stay in shock. Maybe I can come out of this. Maybe I can get past this. Maybe there's something better for me. And they just reassure them, yeah, you can do it. Yeah, absolutely. You're entitled to it. You're entitled to it. So maybe it's been that sort of training for me. It's amazing. I have an amazing situation where I go from the very best places in the world to like the worst places. Just about, you know. It's you never know. Really, it can be just like in the most beautiful, beautiful, wealthy, beautiful places, and then an hour later, I'm like I have seagulls taking poops on me, and stench and chaos and garbage everywhere. And, you know, horrible. And then an hour later, I'm at some other exquisite estate, sitting, you know, looking out over some incredible view with just nothing but gorgeous plants and flowers everywhere and music. And I'm there for an hour, and then an hour later, I'm at the dump again. That's true. It's exactly what I do. And cause I do the cleanup. I do cleanup. From remodels and stuff, to take all the stuff, clean up, needs to get out of there, take it to the dump. So that's part of what I do. So I've just been this alternating, this juxtaposition. It's just amazing. Just amazing. And one day I'll be, you know, one day I could be overlooking the ocean, and then I could be in the redwoods, then I can be in some hillside estate, then I can be some mansion on the plain, then I can be at the dump. Going all the different places, you know, and seeing different people, all different walks of life. You're seeing some billionaire. One moment you're talking to a billionaire, the next moment you're talking to a guy that is just sorting trash at a dump. And for me, it's the same. I don't see any difference. You know, I relate. I don't feel any different relating to one as to the other. Because I say truth is true for you, just the same as it's true for you. It's true, the same truth is for everybody. So I assume this training will come in handy as things unravel, for sure. Someone told me they saw me in a dream where there's utter chaos, suffering, death, sickness is horrible. Everyone was completely freaked out and panicked, and I was there, and I was just completely calm, and I was the only one that was calm, and just nothing was bothering me or affecting me at all. And that I was able to help people, so that's possible. And it's like, you know, could be at an incredibly beautiful spot and then have to leave it and go to the dump. So it's like, well, you know, you can it may be like that you, the service to the world in the future is that you have to go into situations where people are really freaked out, battlefields and all this kind of stuff, and horrible starvation and all these things, and have to help them out and not be bothered by it, and not be bothered by leaving a gorgeous, gorgeous retreat, incredibly beautiful place, and then having to go into this desolate, death-reeking place, reeking with death and sickness and impermanence, etc., and relating to people and helping them, and then going back to a beautiful place and going back and forth, that kind of stuff. That doesn't seem to bother me. Today, right now, I'm in this gorgeous place. Beautiful day, and tomorrow I'll be at the dump. See, I know that already. So, and it's like, well, what can I do? That's okay. One day you're talking to like a genius, that CEO, genius, billionaire, whatever, just, you know, and making small talk. And the next day or next hour, you're talking to some, again, someone at the dump who, you know, probably got a criminal record and this is the only thing they can do. And they're just totally filthy. And they just spend all day in this hellhole. And I'm just, you know, making small talk. Hi, how are you doing? Nice to see you. How are you today? And yes, hey, back in paradise again, huh? You know, and just joking, laughing, talking, and just relating to them, you know, just same thing. Because all dreams are equally unreal. Yeah, and all aspects of reality, no one ever left reality, so all aspects of our reality are equally real. So there's no real difference at all. There's no real difference. It's just appearances. So interesting times. And I meet all different sorts of people, you know, off from the top to the bottom, A to Z. White collar, blue collar, sudras, all different types. And garbage people, street sweepers, just, I mean, I meet the lowest and I meet the highest and everything in between. And they're different, you know, they're different. I wouldn't say one's better than the other, anything like that, because they have their strengths, they have their weaknesses. Some people are very off-putting, but they have their strengths too. Other people are very gregarious and friendly, but they also have their weaknesses. And just have to remain the same with all people, but relate to them in a way that they understand the relating. So I put my garden in early this year because I said, you know what? Better be early. Better be ahead of the curve right now. It's a symbol of being ahead of the curve. I didn't want to be behind the curve. Last year I put it in super late. Super late. The last possible, you know, when Home Depot was like having their blowout sale, wanting to get rid of all the vegetables. It's like I said, oh, I couldn't pass it up. I said, my gosh, they're giving it away. I just had to get some. So I got up the very last part. And then said, wow, I better throw this on the ground. So it wasn't planned out. They didn't have good soil. It was good water, you know, and they struggled. And the deer ate them all. So this year I said, wow, the very first day almost that these vegetables came in, I got everything. It's right when they first came out. But they also had good deals then to get people into the mood of buying. I bought everything. And immediately, we're going to put it in. As soon as the cold spell finally had broken, I said, let's get it in now, because I have a feeling it's not going to come back. It's middle of March, and I think it's going to be safe, and so far, so good. I have a feeling it's going to be okay. It's not going to be any severe, cold weather anymore here in California. So I said, let's go for it. Let's get it done. And so these fruits and everything, they're going to be coming out in what? Middle of April, middle of May, probably. By the end of May, I'm probably going to have all sorts of vegetables coming. Peppers are already flowering. The tomatoes are already flowering. You know, and it's going to be coming by the time of June. In June, it's going to be just, wow, ton of stuff probably. Then July and August, you know, it's just going to, probably I'll have two plantings or two crops, or because it can go all the way through to December. I had tomatoes in December this year, actually still having some tomatoes in December. So, as a symbol, sign of be ahead of the curve now. Let's not be behind. Let's be ahead. Got to be ahead of things. Got to be an early crop. Have to be available for people. Early on, there'll be people who will help. I'll be able to bring tomatoes. Say, look at this wonderful tomato. And they say, why would you get that? I said, from my garden. I said, wow, that's unbelievable. My tomato plants are only like this. And you already got this incredible fruit. Are you kidding me? That's amazing. That's great. It's like that. So some people need to be ahead of the curve. They want to help others. Not everybody needs to be in the same boat of suffering at the same time. What a day. Great day here in California. My gosh. Awash in warm sunshine, warm spring sunshine, just mellow breeze. Birds are everywhere, just chirping. Soft, mellow. It's just this, it's a, everything is mellow. Everything is soft. Everything is greening. It's not too bright. Nothing's harsh. It's just a very mellow day. It's the kind of day where you don't feel like doing anything really, which is great, which is why I'm taping. Those are the best days. The days for me, I always like the days where I feel like you don't feel like doing anything. Those are the great days, because then you can really sit down and dig into truth. Really look at it. You don't feel you're being called to action. There's no call to action. That's like the retreats, the refuges, the place that Jesus prepared, those kind of places. They're like that. Everything's so mellow. You don't feel like doing anything. You're not feeling called to action. But you do feel like calmly and gently examining truth. Focusing on truth. And you can do it all day long because you don't feel like, hey, I gotta go plant something, or I gotta go build something, or I gotta go somewhere and recreate something, or I gotta go, there's no call to action like today. There's a feeling like there's no call to action at all here. Everything's perfect, everything's fine. The garden's already planted, everything's growing. The pruning has been done, the cleanup from all the cold winter. I did everything. I got rid of every sign of death there is here. Every dead, hurt thing. I got rid of everything. Everything's neat. Everything's clean. Everything looks perfect. And so it's that feeling like you don't need to do anything. The lemons are on the tree. Everything's just there. No need to do anything. That's for me. That's what I like. Now for other people, they hate that. They say, oh my God, I'm bored. I can't, there's nothing to do. It's terrible. For me, he said, no. We're able to take a deeper look, bigger look at the big picture and recognize it and say, hey, wow, yeah, I can get free of suffering. Isn't that great? That's better. That's better than going out and recreating, right? I don't even feel like playing golf today. Forget it. Nah, it's too lazy of a day to do that. Rest, and then tape, rest and tape, rest and tape. Sometimes people force themselves to do stuff. They'll take coffee or something to, when they feel too mellow, like, oh, I feel so mellow. I just don't feel like doing anything. They think something's wrong with them. And they'll drink a whole bunch of energy drinks or coffee. So I gotta do something. Gotta get down. No. The best days are the ones where you don't feel like doing anything. Those are the precious days where everything is just so mellow. There's no call to do anything. Let's just sit here. Let's just sit here for 3 hours. And then let's start thinking. Let's start contemplating. Let's talk about bliss. What is bliss? What is depression? How can people be helped? What is real therapy? What is, you know, you start focusing on ideas, on concepts. You start looking at what were the situation we're in? What is the situation we're in? How do we get free of troubles? We start focusing on what's really important. When you're not out there frantically doing. And occasionally I get up and I wander around and look at the yard, so beautiful. I just say, wow, it's like incredibly beautiful, gorgeous. Flowers everywhere. Man, I go back and sit down and do some more taping, and fast progress is made. Fast progress. Whereas if I'm out doing stuff, no progress is being made. Out shopping. My gosh, the pressure to shop is insane, isn't it? Went through all that. Eventually go to the very best stores in the world with the most value merchandise in the world. You look around, you really can't find anything you want. You say, whatever, you know. I don't really want that. Browse around. Say, no, not really. I go on eBay now. I can't find anything I want. I say, no, nothing there. Nothing here. But I know there's nothing in shops that I really want. So I don't need to go shopping. Food, you know, I've had all the best food. Don't really need to have any special food. All I got is sparkling seltzer water here. Just as easily be water. Water's good enough. Do I have to get anything special somewhere? No. Need to go somewhere special? No. Where are you going to go special? How long is that specialness going to last? You know, it's just an attempt to cure depression. It's not a cure. It's medication. It ends up making it worse, basically. Do I need to read something? No. Watch something? No. So you end up just here having a chat, looking at really, really important stuff. Now, of course, everybody else says they could do this too. Sure. But not yet, because they're busy shopping or going somewhere, doing something. They say, but oh, it's easy, I could do that too. But they can't. They can't resist doing something, you know. They can't just sit here and do nothing. They can't just be relaxed and say it's okay, because they think they're missing out on something. See, I'm aware I'm not missing out on anything, really, in the world. No matter what's happening in the world, I don't feel I'm missing out on anything. Doesn't matter, because I know it's all just nothing. Nothing there. There's no cure there. The world doesn't hold the cure. God holds the cure. Bliss holds the cure. Bliss doesn't come from the world. It comes from God. It comes from God's non-judgment upon all what-ifs. So you're not going to find the cure in the world. So, like, what would I do with a whole bunch of money? I don't know. Probably nothing. Do I want to go down and buy a Rolls Royce? Not really. There's a dealership. We can buy a Rolls Royce. Bentley. See Bentley's Rolls Royces all the time. It's like, okay. No, not really. Don't need that. So just sitting here is preferable to doing anything else, really. So then when you're able to see it that way, then you're able to help out, able to focus in on what's really important. which is why I like warm places, places where it is where people don't feel like doing anything. It's so important, so important. What are we gonna do today? I just sit here all day. Just feel like just sitting here and doing nothing. Great, great, great. So let's just sit here, and then let's take a look at something that doesn't require us to go anywhere. You see, the insights here don't require us to do anything or go anywhere. We can look at it. We have the capacity to look and see it right where we are. What's important is that people feel like they don't really need to do anything. They just, let's just hang out here and sit here. Let's not sing a song. Let's not have a music. Let's just sit here and just do nothing. Just simply sit and satsang. Ask questions or bring up concerns of what is depression? Why do we get depressed? And then can give an answer to that and explain it. What's going on with the world? We can talk about that. What's going on with the world? What's going on with the future? What's salvation? What's enlightenment? Just talk about those issues. Those are those important issues. What's going on in the world and stuff like that? It doesn't change the answers to the important issues at all. But if we focus on that, we never get around to just simply sitting and quietly focusing in on what's important. It's a question of focus, a mental focus. And mental focus can only happen like this when you're not all fragmented with other focuses. Because you need to follow through on it. And there needs to be like this gentle kind of familiarization and understanding, which is just really familiarity. It's understanding, it's familiarity, really. When people say, "I don't understand," what they mean is, "I'm not familiar with that." Once they get familiar with it, they say, "Oh, I understand." So it requires this the mind to be able to not be fragmented with, hey, you can sit and your mind can be fragmented and say, okay, what am I planning the future? Like, okay, what am I going to do? I got to go here. I got to talk to someone, make this phone call. And tomorrow's this. Okay, I got to schedule here. I got to budget this. And your mind is like just all over the place. It's really doing instead of just sitting quietly here saying, I'm not really thinking about doing anything at all. I'm not thinking of what I need to do. Thinking of like, well, I don't really need to do anything right at the moment. And then from that, then the mind is able to focus, give its full attention to the question at hand. And full attention is important. It's not a meditative full attention. It's a full attention that comes from the mind saying, hey, I don't need to do anything else. I don't feel like doing anything else. This is all I want to do right now is just look at this. I don't want to go shopping. I'm not thinking of what I need to buy. I'm not thinking of what I need to accomplish, what I need to do. Where I need to go, who I need to talk to, what kind of progression, advancements do I need to make in life, and any of that stuff. What do I need to plant, trim? What do I need to, watch? Anything. Not thinking of any of that stuff. It's just like, everything's perfect. Let's just as it is right now, that's fine. I don't need to do anything. Just let everything just be exactly as it is. So that's why it's important. If you go into a garbage dump, you're relating to people there, you just say, hey, let's just let everything just be as it is. It's all fine. It's no worries. Don't feel like you need to do anything about it. Let's just give our full attention to what's going on. Depression, idols, hypotheticals, prime creator, spirit, mind, non-judgment, salvation, mental chaos, ego, satsang, therapy, go over these key issues. and say, don't worry, let everything, everything's fine. Just let it be exactly as it is, and just be mellow. See, that word mellow, you don't hear that word anymore, do you? When's the last time you heard the word mellow? That was a word in the 60s that was like, that was a number one word. How are you? I'm totally mellow, man. Just very mellow. And mellowing out was very important. What happened when we mellowed out? Satsang, sitting around talking about big issues, big stuff, important stuff, enlightenment, self-realization. But that didn't last, did it? Because you get more responsibilities and families and everything, boom, 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 and you forget about being mellow. That's a very good term. Unfortunately, at that time, many people were getting mellow by drugs. But it wasn't a true mellowness. The thing about drugs is there's always an edge to it, really. It's always, maybe it's too intense, the mellowness is too intense. or it's not going to last. What do I do when I'm not mellow? You know, it doesn't work. Mellowness has to be just natural. You can't induce it artificially. Because it's a genuine mellowness. Like, say, you know what? I genuinely am just okay with being right here as it is, and then focus, giving my full attention to that. Because on the drugs, you end up giving your attention to the mellowness too much. See, the mellowness is not the goal. It's merely something that helps the mind say, you know what, I don't feel like doing anything. But then the mind has to be very clear and pure and sober to look at things. You cannot be tripping out on mellowness and saying, oh, look at that leaf, you know, the leaf is so mellow. Staring at the leaf, or oh, look at that. Oh, and then you think, I want to get that leaf. I want to do something with that leaf. No. They're tripping out on mellow, and that's not it. And again, tripping out on is another phrase of the 60s, meaning you get engrossed into the mellowness or whatever it is you're looking at, instead of what you really need to do is not really feel a need to look at anything. You're not tripping out on the mellowness. You're not tripping out on the beauty of the day. You're just saying, just let everything to be the way it is without me needing to do anything about it. I don't need to focus on it. Just let it be, and then focus in on clarity, clarification. But it's very easy for people to start tripping out on the mellowness of nature or something. Like, oh, look at those shadows, look at that play of light, look at this. And then it completely takes them away from the deeper focus. So sometimes nature can be an extreme distraction. And people prefer like four walls of a room. That can seem very mellow too. On the other hand, it is good to experience the mellowness of nature that lets us know that, hey, nature can be mellow. You know, it is, there could be a mellow nature scenario for me at some point, which there are other dwelling places, death-free realm, just mellow nature, completely mellow. You don't have to do anything at all. Naturally, you know, it just induces like, hey, it's okay, I can contemplate here, I can realize bliss here, for sure. I don't do anything about nature. It's all mellow. You see the sadhus on the banks of the banks of the Ganges and Varanasis, you know, on the ghats, and they're meditating over the Ganges. It's very mellow. Everything's so mellow at dusk or dawn or whatever. And the feeling is, I just don't have to do anything. I just let everything just be the way that it is. Let me forget about the world. Let me turn my mind inward. Let me focus on what's really important. But again, don't use the mellowness for casual conversation. That can be a problem too. Just idle chit-chat is not good. Because then you're just trying to enjoy the moment instead of using the moment appropriately, which is to look deeper. You're just trying to indulge in the moment. Now there's serious business to be done here, because depression is no joke. What's coming in the world is no joke. That is for sure. Let us not minimize that. It's something we really have to get after. But you get after it by being quiet, being still, feeling like you don't have to go do anything. But you still got to get after it. And it's all too easy to let a mellow situation disintegrate into food and drink and chit-chat and laughter and stuff, which is just a complete waste, total waste. Which is why in satsangs the advice is to nobody talk, right? Only the one that there's someone comes up, when someone wants to talk, they come up to the hot seat and they talk to the guru, and everybody else, no talking, no socializing. Very important. Very important. Don't be stealing glances at people. Don't be checking out this person, that person. It's just, no, forget it. Just check out the satsang facilitator. That just for the purpose of, not because they're special, but because, so you're not checking out everybody else, you know? Yeah, that's important. It's just a useful thing. You're not there to hook up, you know, you're not there to any of that stuff. The mellowness is there to feel like you don't really have to do anything except focus in here on what's important. On the big picture, on the abstraction, on the statement of totality without exception. Get used to speaking in terms of no exceptions. No exceptions. And then when you get the insight, don't feel like you have to do anything with it. That's also part of it. You can realize the truth. You can see it. You can say, I see it now. And still you just say, okay, I don't need to do anything. Because ultimately what we're going toward is, of course, bliss. And bliss doesn't have to do anything. Bliss is simply the reassurance that there are no problems in reality. It's not trying to solve any problems at all. Because of the problems, there's no problems in reality. What problems are there to solve? There's no real problems to solve at all. Bliss is just saying you don't have to solve problems. There aren't any. So bliss can just sit quietly and there's no feeling like it needs to do anything. It's already doing what it needs to do. By being what it is doing what it needs to do. So it's important that In getting insight, you don't feel like you need to do something with it. So you need to continue with the feeling of mellowness and not needing to do anything. And of course, at some point you look at your watch, and the parade continues, the parade of days and activity continues, but it's important to have these times like this where you just don't feel like you really need to do anything at all, except to take a look at the key issues. So again, the mellowness is not a narcotic. It's not trying to lull yourself into any state or anything like that. It's just that you feel, you know what, I don't feel like doing anything today. Let me just sit here and contemplate. That's the benefit of it. Which is why, theoretically, a place like California is always attractive to spiritual people, because the idea is that there's so many mellow days out here. But it hasn't really worked out that way. Because the mind finds ways to continue to be very active. I say, let us market this mellowness, you know. That's how we can make a fortune off this mellowness. So let's get busy on that. So it really hasn't worked out that people simply really are make use of the mellowness here in the right way. This place here used to be very mellow, and then that was before the high-tech boom. Silicon Valley, and then the high-tech boom came, and it's become like the most unmellow place on the planet, almost. It's become frantic. It's like a shark tank. It's like an incredibly frantic place. People are desperately trying to grab that fortune, and people work like crazy, and they're so intense. They're so structured, they're so focused on success and innovation, and wow, there's no mellowness. You don't see anybody just, you know, hanging out, just doing nothing, just sitting here like this. What is this, you know? Where is the success? Again, bliss is the only success there is. It's the only true productivity there is. It's truly productive. What productive of what? Success. What is success? Reassurance that dreams don't affect the dreamer. Dreams, what ifs don't affect reality. That's success. So I'm not wasting my time here. I'm being profoundly successful and responsible and progressive. If you want to be a true progressive, satsang, contemplation is the way. If you really want to make progress, if you really want to be productive, satsang is the way, clarification is the way, bliss is the way. We had all these, in the 60s, all these successful hippies, you know. It was amazing. I mean, the hippies, not all of them were just like dropouts, no way. Some of the most successful people in the world were hippies at one time, and they were getting high, and then, you know, but frantically working for success too at the same time. And they'd be mellow, but then they'd be super, super, super progressive and success, going for success. They use the meditation to center themselves so that they can put another burst of massive effort, you know, and then they'd center themselves, get high as a relief from the pressure, and then they go back and push even harder. Hippie entrepreneurs. So that's not it. People who use drugs because their minds are so freaked out about doing stuff, they're just trying to stop it, you know, get out of that. They want to knock that out and get this artificial mellowness. But that's very superficial. It's not a lasting kind of thing. It doesn't provide what's necessary. It's a fight. It's a battle. It's better to spend one's time in clarification. Don't be an old hippie. Don't be chasing after the highs. As you get older, you have to realize, hey, wait a minute. Maybe all these raves and all this stuff, you know, that's not it. I gotta do the work. I really gotta do the work that's effective. I gotta do what's effective. This stuff was just a sort of a mirage, an attempted shortcut that really didn't get the job done. Chintzy, something chintzy, fell apart. Looked good on the surface, but really chintzy. And then don't keep chasing after, you know, don't try to be an old hippie. Don't try to say, hey, let me see if I can stay, you know, keep getting high with the younger people and keep doing all this stuff. And no, you got to mature and say, wait a minute, I better sober up and do what needs to be done. And find out the real root of the situation, find out the real answer. And really get free of depression, really get free of this compulsion of doing, of thinking I need to fix problems. So look at my life, what's my resume? According to the world, I've done nothing, absolutely nothing. But according to the Holy Spirit, I've been highly successful and done an enormous amount. And it depends what measuring stick you use. So if you use the real true measuring stick, then you know, measuring off the charts. Where if you use the world's measuring stick, I'm off the charts on the bottom end. You know, wasted life, completely wasted life. But the key is, I realize I don't need this life. It's not necessary. Not necessary to solve problems. There's only one presumed problem, which is a continuity problem, and that's already been solved. In fact, it never was a problem. And the solution to that problem gives rise to bliss. And bliss is the symbolic reassurance that there's nothing wrong with reality at all. Reality's perfect, flawless, and never be touched by what ifs. And that's all I need to experience that resolves the continuity issues, and then back into the riches of reality, awakening to the riches of reality. No more need for any incarnation or anything like that. You know, that's success. That is success. That's how to measure success. Measure your success of whether or not you got a return ticket or not here. If you got a return ticket here, it's not been a successful life at all. If there's no more return tickets, you've succeeded. And it may seem difficult to get this, but difficult to who? Difficult to those who are trying to fix problems. They say, I don't have the time. I'm too busy fixing the problems. How can I have time? I can't stop that. So it seems difficult. But if you just sit and do and feel like you don't need to do anything except focus on this, then you realize you make incredible progress. And you say, hey, it's doable. It's really doable. If I just sit 3 hours and think about it, it's, yeah. Absolutely, I can get free of cycles of death. Get free of idols. Get free of following the vice of idols is really what it is. And we think that when we die that somehow that saves us. No, we're still listening to idols. The afterlife is still something we've imagined. We're not free of idols at all. Now, it is difficult when you're younger. It is difficult because you have so much more energy. You feel like you're falling behind. You see all your friends are being successful and you're not. It's very difficult, which is why the world has such a problem right now, is this ideal of activity and doing stuff and fixing problems is inculcated at such a young age. youth feeling it as enormous pressure, and they're not going to have any good jobs, and they think they'll be destitute, etc., if they don't do it. Big problem. And what happens is then they wait until they're old and feeble before they start to do nothing, and then by that time their mind is too feeble to have the real intense focus and stick-to-itiveness and that's needed, and they're not able to look clearly, and then they die. Story of almost everyone's life here. So when you're young, you do have to continuously practice quiet times where you're not expected to do anything. Very important for parents to have a life and a lifestyle where the children are allowed to just be quiet and not do anything. They don't have to do anything. Don't pressure. It's not like, I mean, sitting around playing games or doing something like that. This where the kids can just, you can even set the example. We're just going to sit here and quiet, just quiet like this. And maybe you'll bring up a few things, talk about a few things, and how's your life, and how depressed are you feeling, and how agitated are you feeling, and then remind one another of the truth, etc. It's like that. And the children can grow up very calm, as they're able to realize that they can take time like that. They're not being pressured to go, 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 go. They don't have these helicopter parents, you know, hovering about saying, hey, we got to get into the minivan, onto the next thing. This is a disaster for kids. Don't need to name everything. What's this plan? What's the name of this? What's the name of this? What's the name of this? Doesn't matter. Not important. Just say there's nothing important in this world. Just let them know there's nothing important in this world. Nothing truly important. Because that's the truth. This world is nothing but death. There's nothing here that's important. No one you have to go see. Nothing you have to do. It's all unimportant. No importance to it. What's important is seeing this fact and then accepting bliss. And realizing bliss doesn't have to solve any problems. It's solved the one problem, which is the continuity issue. And let the kids see that you don't place any value on the world. You don't see it as important. You don't see coming back here as important. If you place value on the world, of course you think, well, I have many things to do here. I can't do it all in one life. I have to come back here. Say, no, there's nothing here that needs to be done. Nothing important here. Of course, you can do some things if you want to, okay, but it's not important. You don't have to be a big shot here. You can lead a simple life. You don't have to have degrees after your name. You don't have to be someone special or important. Because if the world's totally unimportant, then what importance do you give to the world's handing out importance? shouldn't be important at all. The world says this one's important. Well, if the world's not important, again, what value do you place on its decreeing that someone's important? None. What the world says is important is irrelevant. My God, kids are put under a god-awful pressure. God-awful pressure. The teachers are just vicious. They're so tricky. They use all this enthusiasm and trickery and fakery and stuff. And then whenever they see the kid do something of, you know, like importance, as if the world's important, then they're like, oh, like they're like freaking out. They're so happy. So, oh my God, that's incredible. You did that. You're amazing. You're so special. You know, they just hit you with this stuff constantly. Very wicked stuff. Our educational system is miseducation. entirely. Totally misses the point. And teachers are fanatics about that. Fanatics. They say, I'm going to teach this one that the world is important. That's where they go. That's what it's all about. The teacher. I'm going to teach this student that this world is important and they need to do something here and they need to fix something. They need to get the world to proclaim that they are important too. And this is our home. This is our life. This is real. This is, you know, they want to do everything they can by hook or crook to instill that pernicious attitude in the mind. And if you don't do that, you start ostracizing. You know, you start getting or special treatment, etc. Or you're weird. You need to change. And we got a problem here. And it's just relentless, 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 relentless. Terrible. Do wise people bring children in the world? No. Why would anyone want to bring children into this world? Are you kidding? My God. You try to raise them right, social services will take them away from you. If you try to teach them that there's no importance to this world, they'll take the kids away from you. Make them wards of the state. It's a vicious time here in the world. And they're going to get brainwashed from every possible angle. They're going to be intimidated and bullied from every possible angle here to accept a ruinous ideation, you know, and go in a ruinous direction and to trust and believe in idols and the advice that idols give. And it's disastrous. And they'll get them on all sorts of medication. They'll have all sorts of mental problems. They'll fall into depression. Or frivolity, I mean, it's just our self-importance of the, you know, just disaster, absolute disaster. And people might think, oh, I can handle that. No, the world now is too aggressive. It's too aggressive. As a parent, you can't just thumb your nose at society anymore, can you? It used to be, you could say, hey, I want to raise my kid the way I'm going to raise him, and you butt out, it's none of your business. It used to be that way. You say, I want to raise my kid Christian Science, or I want to raise him to believe that all illness is delusion. And it's not real, and I want to teach them this, and then, no, you can't do that anymore. You get thrown in jail. Because the kid will say to the teacher, oh yeah, my mom believes that this illness is not real. It's just, you know, they'll say something to the teacher, and the teacher will say, ah, what? Oh, you know, the teacher then will immediately go tell the, some superintendent or something, and very quickly, the dots are connected, and social services then visits the family. Then the kid feels terrible. See, the kid says, I wasn't trying to hurt my parents, and then the kid gets pulled out of the family and becomes a foster child. And the kid's like devastated. What did I do? You know, it broke my parents' hearts. Lost my parents just because I just told the teachers something. Just that this is what I believe, and my parents are teaching me, and I like it. I think it's true. And unbelievable cruelty, unbelievable cruelty. We talk about PETA and cruelty to animals. So the big problem in this world is cruelty to people. Stopping cruelty to animals is important too. That's good. That's good too. Absolutely. But while we're at it, why don't we stop the cruelty to people? Who's, you know, how's that going for us? Not willing to do that, are we? Just do nothing. Don't have to solve the problems of the world. Doesn't matter. Dreams don't matter. When we say, what happens to this planet? Doesn't matter. What happens to the universe? Doesn't matter. What happens to... Doesn't matter. Doesn't... What happens to dreams? The dreamer stops dreaming dreams is what happens. And realizes they never had any effect at all. They were just wishful thinking. Just what ifs. What happens to what ifs? Because this is nothing but what ifs. What if this could be real at some point? It'll never be real. So it never was real in the first place. It never had any potential to be real. So there's no loss. It just eventually it'll just all cease to arise. That's not a loss, because it never had any potential to be real in the first place. But try raising kids on that type of ideology these days, you see. So, no, it's not a good time to have kids in this world. Absolutely not. And yet some do, because they say, well, what a great opportunity to be miseducated. What a great opportunity to follow idols now. It's never been a better time to be indoctrinated into idolatry. And then there are others who are wiser, saying, wow, I don't really want to bring children into this kind of situation. And of course, demographically, they're, you know, losing numbers, which is okay too, because things are about to collapse here. And people listen to satsang, some take notes. They gotta be doing something. I gotta write notes, and then later I'm gonna transcribe them, and I'm gonna print them up, and I'm gonna put them in a binder, and I'm gonna study them, you know. But it's more important to just do nothing. Just be relaxed, say, I don't need to do anything. Because that is the truth. There's nothing at all that needs to be done about dreams, except the one dream that solves the continuity problem. Bliss. And that's it. Don't think you have to write a book. I could write 1,000 books. I don't feel like I need to write a book. I could write 1,000,000 songs. I could compose 1,000,000 songs. I don't feel like I need to compose a song. I can produce musicals, operas, symphony, anything you want, I can do it. Don't feel like I need to do that. There's no great loss. There's no great loss at all. Very nice day. Hey, here are all the kids at the park frantically playing, you know, their games and whistles and all this organized activity. All for what? Get older, you look back, say, wow. All for what? I was fortunate enough to focus in on spiritual truth from, you know, from childhood, early childhood. So even though there was play and stuff, but I also was always thinking like, wait a minute, man. I think I forgot something here. Let me not forget. And what's the truth? And that was always going on. But what a hellhole this world really is. I mean, I'm telling you. You talk about the black hole of Calcutta. You know, this world makes that look like a resort. In terms of the pressure to follow the advice of idols, which is the terrible thing. That leads you down into the depression and ultimately experiencing total mental chaos. That this world is ideal for that. Absolutely ideal. It's supercharged for that. So, you know, terrible. It hasn't even become tyrannical yet. I mean, tyrannicalness, you can at least identify it and say, hey, this is tyranny. The world here is like a soft tyranny, which is the worst of all. Because your complaints seem to be over the top. You seem to be eccentric by complaining. Because there's a soft, gentle, sweet, kind tyranny. And your complaints, again, seem to be ungracious and over the top. And you seem to be unstable by making the complaints. Whereas if there's a harsh, brutal tyranny, you say, hey, you know, and people say, yeah, yeah, it's right to complain because look at this harsh tyranny kind of thing. So it's the soft tyranny is the worst. That's what we have here in the world. The sophisticated soft tyranny. Cradle to grave. That's the worst. So you know, from my perspective, this world is the worst of places, really. Very worst of places. Terrible. Most difficult. It's the place where idolaters come. We have a world full of idolaters right now, because it's like heaven to them. It's like a mud hole to a pig, really. Gosh, they think, wow, this is like incredible. The pig sees the mud, and the pig says, oh my gosh, I gotta jump in here. This is incredible. What a great mud hole, you know. And that's what it's like. That's what this world is like. But if you don't want to jump into a mud hole, then you don't like it. So it used to be that people had, you know, negative attitudes to this world. Say they realize, hey, this world stinks. It's terrible. I want to get free of it. Whereas now that seems like crazy. People say, are you kidding me? My gosh, what a blessing to be here in this, in Mother Earth. You know, they sugarcoat it all like Mother Earth, divine Mother Earth. Oh, what a wonderful planet we live on. Aren't we so lucky, you know? And showing you all this kind of superficial, glittery stuff about the planet. Leaving out the incredible, brutal indoctrination into idolatry that from cradle to grave that everybody is assaulted and bullied with here. They leave that part out, don't they? That's the important part, isn't it? That's the important part, because that advice will lead you into severe depression, and that's not a joke. And then it doesn't matter how blue the ocean is, or there's dolphins in the ocean. That doesn't matter when you're severely depressed. You don't care. You don't care there's a bunch of stars sparkling in the sky. You don't care about the superficial wonders of this world. What a joke. What an absolute joke that is. The world holds nothing for you. The world has become a ghastly death hole. You know, it's just like, wow. So it's like the brochures that travel agencies provide for places, and then the travel bureau of a place, and of course they get some really hotshot photographer that can capture a sunset through a palm tree or something in the glossy brochures, and you think, oh boy, I'm gonna go there, it's so great. And you get there and you're assaulted by so many problems, it's just horrible. It's like that. Yeah, a photographer can make this world seem interesting, but it's an illusion. That's for fools. That's for fools. So, we've mastered the arts of advertising in this world at this time. So, the world is advertising itself as this incredibly great place, but really it's just idols are idolatry is being advertised here. So it's attracting those who are attracted to idolatry, which is attempt to accomplish the impossible, attempt to replace God as prime creator, attempts to make hypotheticals real, attempt to make this home, permanent home in dreams, all that kind of stuff, and more, which is just incredible suffering. Attempt to make chaos our natural state, attempt to be satisfied with impermanence, with nothing, attempt to make death real, and then life arise from death, all that crazy stuff, that's what it really is. You know, all this superficial, you know, beauty of this world is just a sugarcoating that. Although the world, you could say it's neutral. We don't have to use it that way. We don't have to use it that way, but that's the way we've decided to use it in this modern civilization, modern world. Man, the old school's not coming back. It's not coming back. I tried to revive the old school. I made huge efforts. No, doing nowhere, like a Led Zeppelin, boom. Didn't get off the ground. Because when you affirm this world, the life on this world, you're affirming death. It's really death affirmation, it's not life affirmation. If you want to affirm life, accept bliss. And bliss is the affirmation of life. The life of reality, which is the one life. The only life there is. You can clean off your house, pressure washer it, and get rid of all the cobwebs, right? Come out a week later, what do you see? All the spider webs are back. That is a fact. Build a, you know, mansion for millions and millions of dollars. Come back and see it, and what do you see? Windows are dirty, spider webs up here, all these spider webs, and leaves caught in the spider webs, and this, some staining here, and it's, you know, starts falling apart. You know, and so people come to this world because they want to follow their idols, and they want their idols to be successful, give them special powers, powers over reality. That's why they come to this world. This world is ideally suited for that pursuit. But it doesn't have to be used that way. You can also just use it to let it be and focus in on dropping the idols. Drop the idols. Drop the attempt to accomplish the impossible. Realize that we're all doing this to ourselves. Idols aren't doing anything to us. Idols are nothing. And then see through the whole charade. And accept bliss. Yeah. It's all very possible, all very necessary. But if not here, we'll have to do it somewhere else. Don't have to do it now, can do it later. Eventually have to do it. Everyone will have to do it. So there's no panic. If it doesn't get done now, it'll be done at some point. But it should be, it'd be good to do it now, because this planet's running out of time. Things are going to change for this planet big time. A different breed of idolater will come into the picture, remodel the structure. You get a house, it's sold. Someone else comes in, buys it, they remodel it, they change it. You go back later and look at it and say, oh, I don't even recognize the place. That's what's going to happen in this world. A different breed of idolater will come here, and ahead of their coming, there'll be an extensive remodeling of the planet. Then they'll come here and they'll terraform it, and they'll have the world the way they want it to be, and follow the kind of idolatry that, you know, they want to follow. And you come back to this world and look at it, you won't even recognize it at all. Which is one of the reasons why people want to desperately, you know, follow their idols now and may be successful before it all changes, which will lead to the collapse. But it could also mean that you say, hey, wait a minute, let's do away with these idols altogether. Let's realize that we are the one in the mirror, and let's get clear about what we tried to do, and what's in clear that the continuity issue is the only issue that we're worried about. We only have one problem, that's the continuity issue. The prime creator solved the continuity issue concurrent with its arising, and the symbolization of that blessing of non-judgment upon all hypotheticals is bliss, and that we can abide in bliss, and abiding in bliss resolves that one concern we have of continuity, and that's all we need. And dreams are not a problem to the dreamer, so we don't have to fix any of the problems of dreams at all. We can realize that just as well as following the advice of idols. We can do that too. Well, and people will say, well, easier said than done. That is true. It still has to be done, though. Still has to be done. But a step backward may be what is required. Basically, what happens is people follow the vice of their idols to the bitter end, and then they realize that idols failed them. At that point, then they're willing to engage with truth and say, I want to know what's going on. But until they realize that idols failed them, they're not willing to engage in the way that they need to engage. So basically, they have to let the world drink a bitter cup to its dregs, and when it gets to the dregs, and they can say, "Ah, I can't drink anymore. This is nothing but dregs." And then you say, "Yeah, let me explain. Let's find out what's going on here." So That's necessary. You cannot please idols and truth, both. And right now the world wants idols to be pleased, to be worshipped, to be propitiated, to be indulged, to be celebrated. So you can't follow lies and truth at the same time. It's not possible. You can't fully engage with both at the same time. It's not possible. So when the world wants to engage full-time with idols, really wants to engage with idols, that you have to let them do that, and they will find out that it doesn't work. And then they will decide, I don't want to engage with idols anymore. And of course, on the path, you have lapses where you go back to idols and say, hey, idol, do you have anything for me? And then the idols, you have problems. So, it's not all just a smooth progression of freedom from that, but you get smart. You learn more and more. You get smarter and smarter and smarter, and you're better able to say no to the idols like that. Because we've been addicted to idolatry for so long, it takes a while to break that habit. But first of all, there has to be engagement with truth, really engagement with it. And that only comes about when you're willing to set down idols and say, no. Don't want that. And so that has to come first. Which is why some people saying, hurry up, we want all the problems to come sooner than later, so they can start helping people sooner rather than later, which is true. It's why wait? Let's get it over with. There's no reason to delay it, really. It doesn't serve any purpose. Let it come. Let the path of idolatry run into the bottom out, reach a dead end, and then people will then be willing to engage with truth. At that point, then there'll be help. So what I'm kind of doing also here is letting people realize that there will be teachers. Don't panic. Don't worry. Definitely teachers. Definitely capable of explaining the situation. You won't have a bunch of complete knuckleheads. Everyone in a complete panic. Everyone freaking out. And there are those who are very clear. Is that know the score, know the game, know what it's all about. There are those. And so you're not going to be forsaken. No, not forsaken, not lost, nor forsaken. Be a temporary thing. Quick bounce back. When you bottom out, it's only for a very quick instant, and then you start bouncing back. Say, wow, let's get out of this quickly. And then the Holy Spirit's always with you. Holy Spirit is not cowed by any situation of idolatry whatsoever. It's always with you. Turn to the Holy Spirit, right? Instantly, you're going to get some help in some way. You may not understand it, but you're going to get the help in some way. And so people will realize this when they bottom out. They'll get help will be there, and they'll say, okay, wow, good. Or actually they'll say, thank God. I mean, you get the most hardcore atheist there ever was. Once they experience mental chaos, and then they're going to pray for help, and when they get the help, they're going to say, thank God. Seriously, no doubt about it. So you look at these hardcore atheists, who are really basically also anti-idolatrous, which is actually a positive thing in one way. But they take it too far in thinking that there is no genuine prime creator of dream, you know. But anyway, you get some hardcore skeptic who just says, nah, don't worry, they will sing a different tune instantly. Once you experience mental chaos, you sing a different tune instantly. Like that, you get the most hardcore, quote unquote, sinner, or whatever you want to call it, the most hardcore that could ever possibly be. The instant they experience mental chaos, their tune will change like that, and they will pray for help immediately. Guaranteed. Guaranteed. So don't be intimidated by all this posturing in the world of people posturing like, ha, scoffers, you know. They're just trolling you, you know. They're full of bravado. They'll instantly sing a different tune. They'll pray for help. They'll receive help, and they'll be grateful for help. They'll say, thank God I got the help. And then they'll pray for more. Because the mental chaos, that brings to that different tune instantly. You don't wait around and say, well, I don't feel like singing a different tune. Oh, no, 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 no. You sing a different tune instantly. It's like jumping into a pot of boiling oil. You know, you jump out real quick. You know, you get the toughest guy in the world and jumps into a pot of boiling oil. They're going to scream and jump out. They're not going to luxuriate in it. They're going to say, oh, it's too hot in this oil. Whew, out. Too hot to handle. So total mental chaos is too hot to handle. There is no tough guy that can handle that. There is no sweet-talking woman that can handle that. You know, you get the most beautiful woman in the world, and she experiences mental chaos, she's going to sing a different tune. She says, wow, my beauty didn't help out there in the slightest bit. Forget about it. It's useless for that. So no matter what the shtick is in this world, you'll sing a different tune. You will instantly sing a different tune. Like bam, bam, like that. That quick. Mental chaos, boom, boom. That quick. Really. It's that quick. The mental chaos, boom, and then boom. So it's like this, boom, boom. Like nothing can faze me, mental chaos, boom, boom. But wow, help, 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 help. Get me out of this, I don't want it. Boom, boom. That quick for anybody, anybody, anybody. No exceptions, there are no exceptions to it. No exceptions. So don't be intimidated by these people who claim that they don't need bliss, they don't need God, they don't need truth. Don't be intimidated by them, because they'll be singing an entirely different tune. The instant they bottom out, they'll be singing an entirely different tune. And then they'll see you as helper and brother and friend, and like, wow, they'll be with you. They'll say, yeah, let's get out of this place permanently. Never want to go back there. Never going to go back there. No way. No way. That's why you often see the big sinners turn into the biggest saints, like a Saint Francis, who was a big time sinner. Really. I mean, he thought he was everything. I mean, he was a, you know, he got all this money and power, and he was a playboy. I mean, he was just wild. He thought he owned the world. Where was his oyster, you know? And for some reason, he suddenly sang a different tune. Must have touched upon that, you know, mental chaos, and boom, changed his tune right away. Threw all his clothes in the street and said, you know, I mean, wow, he didn't mess around. You know, because he must have touched upon it. Saint Augustine, you know, you get these big saints that they were, you know, usually they're like full of braggadocio early on, and then which is defense against depression, then they bottom out, and then suddenly they're singing a different tune entirely. People can't believe it. They say, how's this possible? You know, you were this person before, and now you're just completely different tune. It's like, wow. And they become very severely, they decry, you know, that lifestyle that they had before. They say, hey, that lifestyle is leading you into big trouble. And they become very strict. So you might have the ones that are most, what do you call it? Most given over to the flesh. Later on, they become most adamant that that's not it. Very adamant, you see. They say, wow. Wow, what a bad con that was. What a terrible situation that was. Never want to have that happen again. All right. There's the sunlight. The sunlight's coming through these days. That's great. Finally, the sun is coming through. It's quite some time before the sun actually hit this area. Actually, probably about half of the year, right? Because this is basically around the spring solstice when it actually started actually coming in. So that would mean that at this time in, when is it? September is the, I think it's in sometime in September 21st or something. That would be the autumn equinox. That the sun will also be at the same position in the sky, which will, you know, stop coming in. So it's probably about a 6 month of the year thing. Here. So again, no need to do anything, right? It's, you know, sitting in silence or not is super helpful. You get used to the realization, hey, I don't have to do anything. That's okay. Doesn't make me a bad person. It's actually super valuable. Even in these retreats, everybody's doing stuff all the time. Okay, it's all organized. This. Okay, everybody get in the drum circle. Boom, 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 boom. Let's start our chanting. Tell us your story. Blah, 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 blah. You know, and just, how about just sitting quietly and nobody has to do anything. Don't have to fill up every moment with talk. The train of thought isn't going to be lost. Truth isn't going to be lost. The best teachers are the ones that can remain absolutely silent because they have no problem with answering anything at any moment. It's not like they have to resort to some train of thought. They know the answer instantly. So they don't feel like they need momentum towards that. In my case, I still have to build up momentum. But the best teachers are the ones that instantly know the truth. It's right there. They can say whatever needs to be said instantly. No momentum is necessary. And so those are the ones you feel the sense of like, wow. Don't even need to do anything. And you don't panic because you know whenever there's a question, response, perfect response is right there. Then you can actually practice not doing anything, not thinking anything, not trying to solve anything. The solution is already with us. Bliss, and then bliss is not trying to do anything with anything else. And it's unconditioned, it's not affected by any conditions, doesn't need to be protected. So we get used to just abiding in just this one state of mind. That's it. Now, we don't have it bliss yet, but we can practice just abiding as if we did, in just one state of mind. Get used to it. So then the bliss is welcome. We say, okay, we're kind of used to this. Come on in. Come on in. All right. The screen is now so very glary. So what can I do? Not much. All right. Okay. Well, good time to bring this to an end then. Where's it at? 2:40. 2:40. Well, yeah. I need to check in. I'll check in inside. And tomorrow, get back to work. However, carrying this momentum forward, keeping up with the times, if I could say one thing right now, probably stay away from the news. Stay away from your evaluating where people are at, because it will be kind of shocking to you. It will be shocking, really shocking. So it's better to start to think vertically, think bliss, think that's all I need to do, and these higher considerations, it's better to focus on that right now. And don't worry about the world. Everything's fine. Everything's fine. Bottoming out is fine. Not a problem. Not a problem. Holy Spirit, that's what the Holy Spirit's for, of course. When you bottom out, the Holy Spirit's there saying, okay, let's get to work. Not a problem. It's not intimidated by you bottoming out. It's not. Again, the Holy Spirit is not intimidated at you bottoming out. It is not angry at you bottoming out. It expects it. It knows that's going to happen. It's right there. Ready to go. Always ready. Always effective. Not cowed, not intimidated. And you, like, you're shocked. Like, oh my gosh, mental chaos. Oh my gosh, oh my gosh. There's nothing that can ever help me. I'm done. I'm finished. I'm destroyed. I'm annihilated. And then the Holy Spirit will point something out to you and say, look at this. You look at it and say, huh? I didn't see that before. Or little miracles come in your life and you say, something is not in chaos. There's something that is intelligent. There's something that is not, you know, what is it? What is it? What is that? It's not me, but there's something that is still totally functional. Wow, interesting. And then gradually you make progress and it's fine. Well, we don't have to end this immediately. What can we do? Well, we can do it. We can, like, turn up the color. Turn up the volume. Pump up the volume. I have a light show. Show time. Again, we don't have to frantically get back to something. Okay, we've done our satsang. We don't have to frantically get back, jump back in, make up for lost time. Don't have to. Don't have to go write a book about it. Don't have to tell the world, say, hey, world, I just heard the truth today. So, wow, it's incredible. You should listen to me, you know? Again, the world may want to listen to idols, so may not be interested in what you know at the time. That's okay. Very nice day. It's always a good day to hear the truth. It's always a good time. Is you end up forgetting it, of course, during the daytime, the forgetfulness, and when you go along your day, forgetfulness will come, and you start to feel anxious again, say, wait, I forgot something important, and then let that anxiety drive you back into remembering what it was, and actually, don't try to remember what it was so much, try to take the next step. Try to take the next step. That's what's important. Try taking the next step. And then, boom, you remember like that. And suddenly you'll be free of the shadows somehow, like that. Then you'll forget again, and the shadows will, boom, jump on you like that. See, you'll be back in the shadows. Back like that. So that's, again, you jump out of the shadows. Clarity, and boom, back into them. So you can go back into the darkness, and then you can come out of it. And pretty much that's how it goes. That's pretty much how it goes. You forget, you think, oh, I gotta do all this stuff. What was that about? I can't remember. Then you go back to Satsang, take the next step, and they say, wow, it's clearer than ever. It's clearer than ever. That's great. There must be some jump party somewhere. Some kind of frantic energy, you know? Very great. Let's segue into the end of this video. It's about ready to end anyway, isn't it? Not right. Okay. Very great. Again, stay mellow. Stay mellow. Don't be in a frantic hurry. Even if you have to discipline yourself, let's say, wow, let's not be frantic. Let's not be in a frantic hurry. It's okay to take time to just hang out and listen to satsang. Don't have to be in a hurry. Don't have to. And then one day you'll just be hanging out in bliss. Absolutely. And let that day be soon. Sooner is better, right? I mean, let's let it be soon. But let's not be frantic about it. Okay, great, that's it.